Recalling the sine and cos functions represented by a unit circle, our aim was to solve these functions, to substitute a concrete value for theta and get an output out of it every time. We'll try to visually identify what the solutions would be for a few key input angles, especially at the axes of the circle, where it's easy enough to identify these values. Sine theta is determined by the y-coordinate and cos theta by the x-coordinate. What are the values of x and y when theta is 0 radian? The y-coordinate is 0, and the x-coordinate is at its maximum, which is the radius of the circle, which is just 1. Let's make a note of this and plot it on graphs of values of x and y versus the angle theta as theta increases. When theta is pi over 2 radian, the values are 0, 1. And the next increment at pi radian, the values are negative 1 and 0, since the point is on the negative side of the x-axis. At 1.5 times pi radian, the value is 0, negative 1. And lastly, at 2 pi radian, we get back to where we started and the values repeat themselves. If we connect these dots, we get this zigzag shape, where both sine and cos seem to produce completely a different shape. The reason we get a straight sharp line is because we don't know the values in between the points, and we linearly interpolate when no values are present. The rest of the values in between are actually calculated based on triangle properties of different angles, so let's not dig too deep and get bogged down by the math of it all. But it's easy enough to plot it graphically. Let's fixate only on the sine function for now. If we attach a magical pen that plots the position of the y-coordinate as the angle increases, we see that it plots a curve which intersects the points we had previously marked. And what do you know? You have the sine wave. Now let's focus our attention on the cos function instead, and the x-coordinate. To plot this the same way, we'd have to change perspective and plot it perpendicular to the x-axis. Let's take the same magic pen and plot it out. This is the cos wave. You probably might not have heard of cos waves referenced often. The reason for this is simple. Let's rotate our cos graph and superimpose it on the sine graph. We see that both waves are quite similar to each other. In fact, in the next video, we'll find out they're absolutely the same, just shifted a little. They're both commonly referenced in a family of waveforms called the sinusoids. Now, I want to describe a sine wave, not as a function of the angle, but instead as a function of time. Time-varied functions are extremely useful in audio, and we perceive audio over time, so it's highly likely that we'll use these functions often. So on the x-axis, instead of the angle theta, we have seconds as a unit of time. It's a relative time box where it starts from time of 0 and it stretches on forever. And on the y-axis is the value of the sine function over time. When deriving the sine equation, our aim here is to simply plug in any value of time into this function and get a corresponding value of y, which lies on the sine wave. Since we know that we are describing a sine function here, we are tempted to write y of time is equal to sine of time. And this would be correct, but only for a very specific scenario. We can do better. Let's imagine a sine wave produced from a rotating circle, and the circle is completing a full rotation in exactly 1 second. That would mean the sine wave would complete its full oscillation of 2 pi radian, land back at its original value, and then repeat this all over again. To satisfy this wave, we modify the sine function to include 2 pi. So when the time increases from 0 to 1 second, the function operates over 0 to 2 pi radian and then increments by 2 pi radian every second after that. This is one such possibility of the makeup of a sine wave, but they can be quite varied and different. For example, they could have a larger radii than a unit circle. They could rotate several times a second instead of once every second. They could even be cosine waves rather than sine waves. So in the next video, we'll describe an equation for a generic sinusoid, one which can represent any wave with simple harmonic motion, and we'll break down some of its properties and talk about what its effects are in the real world. After the next video, you should be in a position to visualize what a wave would look like just based on its equation. If you feel like you aren't at that point yet after the next one, or still have concerns over wave formations, I encourage you to give this video another watch. I think a lot of intricacies and nuances are left unsaid, and better left explained through illustrations and your own inference instead.